ilahi
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. My name is Wissam Bazzi, and welcome to Brother to Brother. First of all, we just want to wish you a happy Eid here from Brother to Brother, and hopefully you have a great holiday and enjoy it and spend it with your family. Now, we're going to talk today about the significance of Eid, how we should spend it, how we should plan for it, family, friends, the significance of Salah on this day. And we have a perfect guest to talk to us about this, Haj Aus Asfar. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm far from being a perfect, so, but I appreciate you being here. Eidkum Mubarak, Ayamkum Saida. Congratulations on this happy day, inshallah, on this joyous day, on this joyous occasion. May Allah bless you all out there and bless you, Haj Wissam, and your crew. I thank you for having me once again on the show.
Thank you. We're honored to have you here. Please just talk to me first about how one, you're reaching the last days of Ramadan, and it's almost coming to an unfortunate, you know, end of Shahr Ramadan. How should one be planning for the Eid? How should I plan my whole day out, you know, friends, family? What should I be thinking of this day that's coming?
I think the most important thing that we should all remember and not forget is that last day of the month of Ramadan, you have to take out what's known as Zakat al-Fitra, okay? We must not forget this, all right? This Zakat al-Fitra is a charity, okay, that you have to give to your, you can give to your Islamic center, and they'll give it to the needy and the poor, but it is ordained upon us that we must give this charity. Usually it's between $5 to $10, you know, depending on where you are, so make sure not to forget it. You have to give it for every person that is in your household. All right. So if you decide to invite people over on that last day for iftar, okay, either ask them to bring their own date with them if you have a huge crowd, or you have to pay zakat fitra for each one of the people that are in the house, or have them, you know, break their fast before they come in to your house with like a date or something, and then they come into your house and they eat, you know. And do not forget, this is very important. You have to give your zakat al-fitra at the end of the month. Now, that's one thing.
Haji, one thing is, what if like something happens and I can't get to the mosque or I can't do it that day? Can I put it aside? What can I do in this situation?
Well, if you can't get to it that day, actually it's highly recommended, even when the month starts, is to set that money aside, okay? So you can actually set it aside or put it in the hands of somebody who can deliver it either to your Islamic center or to, you know, the Islamic organization. Or I know that some organizations such as imam-us.org, you can actually pay your zakat al-fitra online. It's actually that simple these days, you know. So yes, you can set it aside, but as quickly as possible, make sure, like if it's a last minute thing and it's the last day and now you're into the day of Eid, okay, and it's not the first day, the first day of Eid has passed and you're on the second day, you know, you're letting things wait too long, okay? Make sure that you get it out there as soon as possible in the hands of somebody who's going to give it to the needy, okay? That's very important. But yes, you can set it aside, okay?
Now, since we're on the subject of planning, what are some of the most important points I should be planning for?
Well, when planning, we're not just planning for ourselves. We have to plan for our environment, for our surroundings, for the people that are a part of our lives, which not only includes our direct family, like, you know, your wife or your brothers and sisters or your children or your mother and your father, but also your work environment, you know. I mean, if you haven't told your coworkers that, you know, you were fasting during the month of Ramadan, really consider doing that for next year, okay? Let them understand why it is that, you know, you sometimes look pale or drained, or you can't have that drink of water, or you can't go out to lunch with them. And they will understand, and they will respect you for it, okay? From personal experience, I can tell you that. That's one. Secondly, is have your boss understand that, you know, for example, the nights of Qadr, you might need the next day off because you're up, you know, all night. That's one. Secondly, the fact that you have Eid, and that Eid is this joyous festive occasion where, you know, family, friends, and community get together to celebrate the Abrahamic sacrifice of the lamb. Correct? Mm-hmm. And so what you're doing here is you're bridging the gap between you and the other religions and making them feel like this is not just a festive occasion for you, it is a joyous occasion for them also. You know, and making them part of that becomes very important in our interfaith efforts. And you know, when they feel like, for example, they invite us to their Christmas parties. They don't invite us to the Christmas parties, you know, just because, you know, just to invite us. They invite us because they want to celebrate with us, and we should make them feel the same, that we also want to celebrate, you know, something that's important to us, to them. And it's definitely something that, you know, the Abrahamic religions, faiths can relate to.
Let's say I have some Christian friends, Jewish friends, and I want to invite them over on this joyous day. I want to invite people from the church, from the synagogue, and to make a little gathering, to show them what we do throughout this, you know, joyous holiday. How do I go about doing this?
Well, I think going about doing it is actually quite simple. You just, if you're part of an organization, you know, prepare an official letter, send it to them. Also, pop by, tell them I'd like to speak to the pastor or the preacher, you know, or the reverend, whoever it may be, or the rabbi, and say, you know, we wanted to invite you to our to this joyous occasion, this festive occasion of Eid, which celebrates the Abrahamic sacrifice of the lamb. And then they'll ask you questions if they don't already know. Most likely they already know. If they don't, then you can educate them, you know, and invite. Tell them to invite some of their congregation, because this is a great opportunity for people to understand Islam and to understand, you know, how similar we really are, you know, at the core when it comes to some of our beliefs.
Now, I've actually done this. I've invited everybody over, but what's the next thing I should be thinking about or I should be doing?
Well, the next thing is it's important to really create that atmosphere of Eid in your household. And if you are a father or if you are an older brother, you know, and especially the young, you know, dads out there, you're really trying to set the tone for your family. I remember the first time I took my first daughter, Zainab, to Eid. She wasn't even a year old, you know, and we dressed her up and, you know, we made her feel like it was a joyous occasion. And the first thing that we planned for is to make the Islamic center part of that tradition. It is highly recommended to go and pray the Eid prayer in congregation. Now, if you don't have an Islamic center near you, we're blessed, alhamdulillah, to have many Islamic centers here, but if you don't have one near you, you can pray it in your home. Invite some of your Muslim friends over, okay, and pray in congregation. All you need is 5 people for this prayer. It's outlined in Mafatih al-Jinan. It's also outlined in Islamic laws. And it's you know, very easy to pray, but it's highly recommended to pray it, okay? Now, when you invite the people over, you know, also plan something out, like, you know, visiting people. It's highly recommended to visit people, visit your friends, visit your family. Obviously, start with your family. Al-aqrabuna awla bil-ma'ruf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. You know, start with your close of kin. Visit your brothers, your sisters, you know, visit your neighbors. The Prophet ﷺ, you know, tells us about the importance of your neighbor. So visit your neighbors, visit other people that are, you know, that are your friends. Even, you know, I would even say, visit some of your Christian friends that don't know, or invite them over, as we mentioned before. Now, when you do that, you create that atmosphere of joy. Decorate your house. You know, I mean, Christians decorate their homes for Christmas. You know, you should be decorating your home when Ramadan comes to welcome the holy month of Ramadan. You should decorate your home for Eid, you know, inside and outside. Okay, make your children at home feel like this occasion is something that they will always remember. You know, growing up, one of the happiest days that I remember having are those days of Eid, remembering how all of the uncles and the aunts and the grandparents, they got together, how we had dinner together, how, of course, we prayed together first at the mosque. Then we all had breakfast together after that. Then after that, you know, we all, you know, went out and visited people. We'd go out and visit people. Then after that, we'd get together again, you know, and have lunch together. And that's very important. Until the end of the day, that's all you're doing. Visiting and being visited, you know. Showing people the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the joy. So show the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this beautiful, joyous day. Give charity. Part of planning for Eid is understanding that, you know, just like in the holy month of Ramadan, our holy prophet highly encourages us to give to the orphans, to make them happy, to give to the needy, you know, to give charity, to be generous when you're giving, you know. Part of preparing for the month of for Eid is that during the month of Ramadan, at your holy mosque, put together a food drive, you know, put together a clothing drive, get new clothes, get new gifts, a gift drive, you know, for those who are needy in your community. And if you don't know who is needy in your community, you should go out and try to find out who is needy, okay? And one of the things that we would suggest is not just those who are Muslim. Show how merciful we are as Muslims and how charitable we are by even giving charity to those who are non-Muslim, you know? Now, of course, start with those who are Muslim. But if there are people in your community who are also needy and are non-Muslim, show them how beautiful a religion Islam is and how generous it is and how generous the followers of Islam are by giving to them. You know, our holy prophet was known for doing that, so were our imams. And we should follow that same path.
Now, one issue that comes up usually at Eid is sometimes it becomes a little materialistic. And a little, I look at it, okay, I'm just going to gain some money. I'm just going to, you know, obviously it's for younger children. But what role can the parents play to kind of remove this misconception of Eid?
I know that it's commonplace on this Eid to give kids money. Is something that's done not only, you know, back in the Middle East, but also here. And so a lot of the kids, they, you know, they're so involved in how much money they're gaining for Eid. I think that it's very important for us to understand that it is important to give gifts during those days. So, because our Holy Prophet says, "Tahadu tahabu," that give gifts and those gifts will build bonds of love between you. And so it becomes important to give gifts. But let's give it a twist. Let's give each other gifts. I will give my father a gift, you know. My father will give me a gift. But maybe make that gift something that's not just materialistic, not just money, you know. Give a gift of, for example, a book. A book that will help that person seek knowledge. A lot of people will say, "Well, that's so boring," you know. And let's say, okay, let's start by, when we give gifts, let's not just think about ourselves. Let's give to the needy. So hone that feeling of gift giving. Don't break it in your kids. No, instead channel it. Channel it towards giving gifts to the needy, okay? Channel it towards giving, not caring too much about what you receive. Make sure that you program them. And literally, you're programming them, you're telling them, you know, don't just worry about what you're going to receive. Make it more important for you to be a giver, you know. Give, all right? Give to your sister, give to your brother, give to your father. As a parent, make your children think about giving to the needy and giving to those that they love, okay? Giving to those they don't know who are in need and giving to those who they love. That's very important. We definitely can't emphasize that enough, right? And start at a young age. The younger you start, the more likely they are to remember this and to make it part of their tradition, part of their lives. So if from a very young age, you grow up, you know, thinking, oh, you know what, Eid is coming along. We have to really do something to start, you know, gathering gifts for those who are in need, for the orphans, you know. Let's put together a collection box in the community for the orphans in Iraq or locally or in, you know, in Lebanon or in Pakistan or, you know, in India or in Africa or in other, you know, places that are needy, where people are in need. So making that a tradition is what's going to break that sense of materialism, you know. But I tell you, I remember as a child, and there are a lot of negatives to, you know, giving money as gifts, But I remember as a child, I still remember this one personality in my life. Her name was Hababa. And I mention her, and I want you all to recite Fatiha on her soul. Because I remember as a child, my father, she was a very old woman. And my father, every Eid, would take us to her home. And she was a distant relative. She wasn't even a close relative. She was very, very distant, far removed. But he always took us to her. And she always gave, she always gave what would be equivalent to, it was a lot of money for a child to receive. What was equivalent to about, I think, $50, close, between 50 and 75. You know, as a idea, as a gift. Yeah. To this day, I remember her. To this day,
mashallah.
You know. And I have to say, one of the reasons why I remember her is because my father made it a point that we go and visit her, that we go and visit the extended family. That even though he never said, you know, oh, you know, Hababa gives you good ideas, good gifts. We always thought, wow, we should really go because, you know, at that time, Hababa gives us great gifts, you know. Peace, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yarhamah, inshallah. But to this day, I remember her. And that, you know, I think that that monetary gift and remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us, was gracious enough to give us a father who remembers his relatives, you know, distant or near, on these days and on other occasions, you know, really cemented the idea of the importance of visiting family. That as a child, the child might need some incentive, you know, and the gift becomes a good incentive. But match that with the care and the kindness, you know, and the grace that is there with you remembering your relatives and those who are not just in need of things that are monetary, but are also in need of emotion and affection and your kindness, you know, that instilling that in your kids and doing it early on, matched with a little gift, because if the gift wasn't important, our Prophet wouldn't say tahadu tahabu, right? He's encouraging us to give gifts, whether monetary or otherwise. I think that's the best way to really, you know, curb that materialism and make sure that it's under control.
Now, as a parent, okay, my kids collect all this money and they're having joyous time, they're having a great time. How do I control the spending of this money as a parent? How do I put some limitations or limits on this money? And I just let them go like a free fall and just do whatever they want.
I think it would be worthwhile for us to really consider this point. To instill in our kids from a very young age that in that money that you receive in gifts, that you should set a little aside as charity. Okay? If you do that, what will happen is automatically the child will learn and be programmed to always have something aside for charity. And to know that that charity that he gives or that she gives will go directly into Allah's hands, metaphorically, of course. Because there are riwayat, there are hadith that say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself receives, you know, the charity. He doesn't, for everything else, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a representative. For revelation, Allah has angels, you know. For Allah has the angel Gabriel. For death, Allah has the, you know, the angel of death. For so and so, he has the angel. So he has representatives, but for charity, Allah has no representative. Charity goes directly to his hands. You know, metaphorically speaking, of course. And it was known that Imam Baqir, salamullah alayhi, when he would give charity to somebody, he would give the charity in their hand, then he would take their hand and smell it, you know, just to feel the closeness to Allah, metaphorically, of course, you know. So instilling that love of charity and giving, and I know that there are some organizations out there that actually do that. Like I know, for example, myorphans.org is a great place to go and sponsor a child. Make that, you know, say, okay, one of the things that we should do is sponsor a child, an orphan child, this Eid, and make that part of their tradition. And it's very easy to do online. You can go to myorphans.org, or you can go to your local orphanage and maybe sponsor a child. Go to your local organization that actually sponsors orphans, Muslim orphans, whether abroad or here, okay? And make that part of their vocabulary. The other thing that you can do is also, other than orphans, is look at organizations. There's a wonderful organization out there in our community here called the Zaman International. They have many different programs that they have throughout the year. They also conduct food drives here locally, I know. So do the mosques. So do other organizations. And what they do is they look, they find families that are in need, and they do food drives, okay? And if you don't know where to go, they know. They know what families are in need. And so you would, give them even food or money or gifts, you know. Just the other day, my wife was saying to me, you know, Eid is coming along, and it's coming along fast. We should really go out and buy gifts for these, for some of the kids, you know, through Zaman. And I think that would be a wonderful contribution, that if you get your family to think that way and to plan that way. So making that part of their repertoire, you know, will help kind of ease that whole materialism, you know. Controlling how they're spending the rest of the money, obviously, is very important.
So actually, Haji, this is a great way to remove selfishness from a child at a very young age, to actually teach them about charity and how to give, their obligations maybe to the poor, you know, to instill this at a very young age. And maybe give a little bit, give a little time to explain, you know, about putting some of it in the bank and mm-hmm. doing that as well. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that idea?
I think that's a wonderful idea. I mean, making it, even subhanAllah, like, let's say for example, you open up an account for your child, okay? And you're saving for them, you're teaching them how to save, you're teaching them that whatever they get, they're sharing with others, that a certain percentage, you're setting them up to learn about zakat and khums. That's really what you're doing. Imagine how much thawab how much reward you'd really get for that, you know? And so it becomes a much easier transition once they reach the age of puberty, you know, of taklif, that they understand that very simply, it becomes very easy for them to understand the concept of khums, you know. Also, I think what's really important is when you're teaching them about how to save and you're teaching them how to give charity, you're also teaching them about how to spend wisely, okay? How not to overspend, that tabdhir is something that can happen, you know. Don't let your kids go out there and just, you know, go buck wild, just spending, you know, buying, you know, so many things that they don't need, you know, just because it's fun, you know. Yes, it's important for them to have fun. It's important for, because through enjoyment, religion is really a religion of ease. There has to be an element of enjoyment there. It can't all be usr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna ma'al usri yusra," that with that squeeze, there's going to be, you know, ease. You know, that yes, it is a world where you're tested all of the time. This is part of that test. You're teaching them early on. You're giving them the tools early on to be able to pass that test, okay? From taking them to salah early on, from maintaining that salah, from having that salat al-raham, you know, while teaching them to go and visit their relatives. You're teaching them to give zakah. You're setting them up for khums. And you're teaching them how to save. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you give, don't, you know, hold your hand right to your neck, you know, tightly, so that you don't give at all, and don't open it up completely, you know, so that you sit back and you're thinking, oh my God, I gave too much, I have nothing for myself. You're hitting all of those elements, and that's what's going to make a well-rounded child and a happy child. And subhanAllah, Shahr Ramadan and Al-Eid were the elements that you used to be able to perform all of that.
Haji, that's some great advice on how to take a beautiful day and a joyous day and remove the materialistic ends of it and turn it into something that your kids can learn from and they can truly, truly benefit from in so many different ways that the Haji here obviously explained. Again, we would just want to wish you a blessed and happy Eid and holiday, and enjoy the sweets, enjoy the food, enjoy the gatherings, and we will also want to just wish you a happy Eid, Haj Aus, for coming on to the show and giving us your advice and your input.
Well, thank you. It's my pleasure. Again, I wish, you know, your wonderful viewers a joyous Eid, inshallah. May Allah bless you all and bless the entire Muslim world and the entire world, inshallah, on this joyous occasion. May Allah bless you all for your wonderful work and your hard work. I know it takes a lot of effort to get this done. And I'd again like to mention, don't forget, go to your Islamic centers if you can, if they're available. Make sure that you do your Salat al-Eid. Make this a wonderful, happy tradition for your kids and for your family, something that they will always remember. And also, don't forget the needy, you know, don't forget to give the charity. So many people are out there are in need, you know, and sometimes we tend to, you know, think that it's just us that's out there. And I know all the viewers there obviously remember and they give charity. And inshallah, I will inshallah remember to give charity. I remind myself before I remind anyone else. May Allah bless you all, inshallah, and thank you again for having me. And again, there are websites out there where you can pay your zakat al-fitra, and websites out there where you can give charity. A good one that I go to is imam-us.org. You can go there, you can sign up, and you can actually pay online, and it's wonderful.
Again, thank you for the great information and great advice, and again, we wish you a happy Eid. And we also wish our audience again, I'd like to extend my hand out again, tell you happy Eid and enjoy this blessed time. And if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about this show or any future shows or future show ideas, just give us, drop us an email and we'll be happy to respond to you. Inshallah, we'll see you next time. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ilahi. أسأله